Welcome, everybody. My name's Rob Levin. I'm the current president of Portland Trails, and happy to be here tonight. Let's do a little bit of Great Wind Blows. Anyone know that game? It's like a, you know, elementary school game, but a Great Wind Blows. When I say a great wind blows, and if you fit the description of what I'm talking about, then just stand up, okay? And then we're gonna celebrate everybody. So, first of all, a great wind blows for everyone who is a Portland Trails member. Woo! Stand up. Okay. Now, another great wind blows for everyone who is a Portland Trails trail volunteer. Stand up. All right, round of applause for our trail volunteer. A great wind blows for everyone who's volunteered at an event. Stand up. All right, thank you. People are volunteering tonight. A great wind blows for anyone who's presenting tonight as part of the 15 by 15. All right. Thank you, guys. And a great wind blows for anyone who is not a member yet, but is a member to be. Like, by the end of the evening, we've got membership. We have membership forms in the back. We want to not be obnoxious about it, but we really want you to join. Membership is the lifeblood of our trail system, so please think about grabbing one on your way out or during the break, and then you'll be in the loop for all these kind of cool events in the future. So, I had a spy checking out who stood. No. Okay, we're not going to be like that, but let me get this down one. Okay, so real quick, I wanted to talk about a few highlights from last year. Just covering some of the basics. We had a long list, so I had to winnow it down, but we have some new trail connections in Westbrook, especially at the skate park there and at the Blue Spruce development. Anyone been to either of these? We got somebody? Skate park? Blue Spruce? Okay. How's it looking? Good? All right. So check it out on the website. Jamie's been working hard with Daniel out there, and we want people to go explore some of these new places. So that was one thing that happened last year. We upgraded the Four River Trail between Hobart Street and Thompson's Point. Who's been on the new and improved Four River Trail? All right, not too many hands. I actually haven't, so check that out. The whole idea is to make it more commuter friendly for people traveling into town from Westbrook, so check that out. Lots going on. We have a new website. Who's seen our new website? All right, Andy Abrams was a real big volunteer help for that. That just launched, I think, 2 or 3 weeks ago. So check out our new website. It's real clean. It looks great. So those are some fun things that happened in 2015. So 2016, who knows why 2016 is special for Portland Trails? No, not if you're on the board. You gotta be somewhat. Come on, somebody. 25, 2016. So yes, it's our 25th anniversary. All kinds of cool things happening this year. We're having monthly pop-up parties. Who had cupcakes in January in the park? So things like that are happening. Small things, big things. We're having a big party in April, Gorp. We're having another party in June. So stay tuned. Lots going on to celebrate our 25th anniversary, including we are trying to secure 25 bequests by the end of our 25th year. You do not have to make good on your bequests by the end of the year. We're asking for people to tell us, yes, I've updated my will, or I've prepared my will for the first time and Portland Trails is in it, then you'll be one of our 25 by 25. Right now we're somewhere in the high teens. We're getting there, but we really need a few more people to step up. So you could be the one. Please think about that. You don't have to be, you know, you don't have to have fancy estate plan. It can just be a really simple process. So talk to Kara or me if you're interested in hearing more. We also have a brochure, Leave a Trail. It's in the back at the table there, so that has some more information about that. But please consider being one of our 25 by 25. Some other cool things that are happening this year. So we have a new committee, a placemaking committee, and that's a reflection of our strategic plan, which we finished last year. We decided we want to not just be about getting from point A to point B through traditional trails. We want to also be about making parts of places in Portland special, destinations. Sometimes they'll be affiliated or aligned with the trail, sometimes not. And there's lots going on there. There's some neat new projects that are popping up. So you'll hear more about that this year. The other thing is we no longer have a trails committee. I just wanted you guys to know that. Don't be alarmed, though. What we actually have is a Trails and Transportation Committee, Active Transportation. We've transformed a little bit. The Trails Committee is now the Trails and Active Transportation Committee, reflecting, again, the strategic plan focus on making it easier to get around Portland for commuting and recreation, not just going on a trail through the woods, but getting from one neighborhood to the other. So I think that's really exciting. There's a lot of energy around that, and you'll hear more about it this year. We've got two new board members. Jennifer Kutchel, I'm not sure if she's made it tonight, or Bill Hall. I'm not sure if Bill's here, but we'll be voting on them. We're excited about them. And I'm done with my list. I will keep it moving and hand it over to Wendy. Thanks.
Hi, good evening. Thanks so much for joining us tonight. I have the pleasure of going through really the bulk of the boring annual meeting part of things, so get ready for that. The reality, though, is that undoubtedly some of our most dedicated volunteers are, in fact, our board members. We certainly could not achieve all that we do without their passion, their enthusiasm, their energy, and hard work. So I would like to first start by introducing our board. And if you're here, please stand so that you can be recognized. So Rob Levin, our president. My name is Wendy Sirsted, the vice president. Matt Ball, our treasurer, just texted that he's stuck in New York, so unfortunately will not be joining us this evening. Rachel Alfont, our secretary. Andy Abrams, our immediate past president in the back there. Mark Arienti, the chairperson of our Trails and Active Transportation Committee. Jennifer Kutchel, Nate Dyer, is Nate here? Tom Farmer, Steve Gall, he's here in the front. Alex Yeagerman, thank you. Tom Jewell, one of our co-founders. Kate O'Brien, hi Kate. John Osborne, Stephen Wells is here, and Rob Witten. So thank you so very much to all of our board for your your commitment and ongoing advocacy for Portland Trails. Along with our board, we also have a wonderfully dedicated team of advisors who are very helpful on all kinds of different fronts and subjects, bringing lots of expertise to the organization. Again, I'm going to go through the list. If you're here, love to have you stand up and be recognized. So we have Colin Baker, Roger Burley, very longtime supporter, David Buchanan, Heather Chandler, Jim Cohen, Elizabeth Ehrenfeld, Tom Hyman, Susie Kist, Bob Krug, Wendell Large, hi Bob, David Little, Berna Martin, J. Peter Monroe, Phil Poirier, Eliza Cope Nolan, Aurelia Scott, Nathan Smith, one of our co-founders, Richard Spencer, one of our co-founders, Phil Thompson, and Lois Winter. Please give these important people a hand. The following board members are up for re-election, each with a three-year term. Nate Dyer, Stephen Wells, Rob Levin, and John Osborne. I need a motion to accept this slate of trustees for re-election. Any dues-paying member of the organization has one vote. And following in Rob's footsteps, if you haven't paid for your membership in the past year, you can quickly run to the back table and do so and have a vote. So with that said, do I hear a motion for this proposed slate of trustees?
So moved.
Thank you. Do I hear a second? Thank you. Is there any discussion? All right, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, thank you very much. A unanimous vote. And at this point, I was going to turn it over to Matt, our treasurer, but that will not work very well with him in New York. So what I will say is that, thankfully, Portland Trails remains on very sound and solid financial footing. Thanks certainly in no small part to all of you, our members of Portland Trails, to all of our corporate supporters and sponsors, and to the many foundations whose grants help us to continue doing our work. There is a full financial report on the back table. For those of you interested in detailed information, absolutely pick up a financial report and let us know if you have any questions. Just call into the office. Kara would be happy to address any questions that you have. So thank you for your support. Thank you for making Financial Trails financially strong and continuing in our ability to do great work for Greater Portland.
Welcome to the Portland Trails 15 by 15. My name is Kara Woldrick. I'm the Executive Director of Portland Trails. Wow, you guys are easy. This is great. Thank you to Space Gallery for hosting us. Thank you to CTN, Community Television Network, for being here and filming tonight's event. Thank you to Legion Square and Standard Bakery for yummy treats out back. Thanks to our members, volunteers, board members, staff, and staff families. Everybody pitches in regularly for Portland Trails, including many of you, so thank you. This year is our 25th anniversary. Happy birthday, Portland Trails. So, as a millennial, Portland Trails sort of fits the stereotype. Multitasking, connected, tech savvy, special, confident, team oriented, achieving, looking for adventure, passionate about values and equality. We want instant gratification and recognition and collaboration and transparency. So, in the spirit of constant status updates, I'll give you a little information about where Portland Trails is right now. We have a new website. We have a new property in Trails in Westbrook that we aren't going to announce publicly until another month or so. So you're on the inside track there. We're doing placemaking work in East Bayside throughout this coming year. We're always involved in cycling and walking transportation options in Greater Portland. Sundays on the Boulevard, we'll be back in just a few months, closing Baxter Boulevard to autos on Sundays from about 10 to 4. We're celebrating our birthday with pop-up events every month. Hopefully you didn't miss the cupcake party, but if you did, we have a puppy party coming up pretty soon. And as we get older, we're a little more strategic and future-oriented than we ever have been before. While we create a lot of fun with what we do, we have some pretty serious responsibilities. For a 70-mile trail network, for improved bike and pedestrian transportation network in Greater Portland, for conservation of important local ecosystems, and for creating dynamic environmental play and learning opportunities that are developmentally appropriate for children of all ages. And we still have some experience to gain, some things to learn, some growing up to do. We need to raise money to secure the future of the trails, and we need to tell our story better to the million plus users. Wow. We need to better tell that story of a small urban land trust with a big heart and an even bigger footprint. We all have stories to share, and tonight you will meet some amazing people who are brave enough to take the challenge to come up here and tell their stories restricted to the 15 by 15 format. For that alone, they deserve your admiration. Combined, tonight's stories will reveal the character of this community. It's easy to see where our neighborhoods, city policies, transportation systems, our schools are not doing well. It'd be easy to complain about that, to whine, to whinge, but it takes an entirely different spirit and set of skills to instead see an opportunity and take action to fix it. That's the spirit of tonight's presenters. These are the doers. These are the solutioneers who resolve problems by creating positive processes and outcomes. Portland Trails is honored tonight to host some of Portland's rock stars. It is their spirit and their tenacity and humor and mindfulness that make Portland Trails community unique. Thank you to each of our presenters. And thank you to our audience. You guys have a job tonight too. You have to support the brave presenters with cheers and thumbs up and yeehaw and whatever spirit moves you. That's helpful when you're up here. You have yeah, let's give it another try. You have stories to share of moments when you chose to take action, when you decided to make a difference. So we intentionally have an intermission in between the presentations, and that's for you to get to know each other, to share your story, to get a drink, to relax, have some snacks. But don't be shy during that time, because our community is strengthened when you share those stories. I'm thrilled tonight to introduce our MC, Tom Nozel. Tom's an engineer at Ransom Consulting. And last year he was right here presenting on bike ped counts. And at some point asked Tom about his huge win in the GORP raffle last year. This year's GORP is April 28th at Arabica on Commercial Street. We hope you'll join us, but first, here's Tom, and he'll tell you how this all works.
Thank you, Kara. Thank you. How's everybody doing tonight? All right. Everybody ready to nerd out a little bit on some transportation? Hope so. Like Kara said, I was a presenter last year, but I haven't done anything in the last year worthy of presentation, so they asked me to be the MC this year, and I gratefully accepted. So welcome to the Portland Trails 15 by 15. Tonight we're going to hear from 9 people who are all over the map, lots of different experience, different backgrounds, different fields of work. And they're going to talk about how they're working to improve transportation here in Portland. And these brave people have 15 slides that change every 15 seconds. So it's just under 4 minutes. They're pre-timed. They don't control the timing. They just got to roll with it. And let me tell you, it's a lot harder. They're going to make it look easy, but it's a lot harder than it looks. So we'll hear from 5 of them first, and then we'll have a 15-minute intermission. Like Kara said, that's when you get up and talk about what you've just seen. You have 3 rules to guide you tonight. First is cheer wildly for each presenter. The second is listen attentively and discuss passionately. More or less in that order, not at the same time. And also, please turn off the ringers for your cell phones. If you haven't done so already, please do so now. And presenters, when you, like I said, your presentations are pre-timed. So when you're ready to begin, you ring the bell once. And the presentation will start. And I've also been instructed to remind you that if you want to turn, the farther you get away from the mic, the quieter you are. So please try to stay close to the mic. If it helps, you can remove the mic. And if you want to kind of, walk with it, that's your choice. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce back to the stage Kara Woldrick, the executive director of Portland Trails. Kara grew up in a much warmer place where outside time was a daily occurrence. At 7 years of age, her favorite hobbies were climbing trees and having picnics with her dog in the backyard. And her preferred activities have not changed much in the past 30 years. She enjoys riding bikes, kayaking, trail running, skateboarding, cross-country skiing, as they are all vehicles to experience the natural world firsthand. Kara is convinced that places shape people as much as people shape places, and she also believes that playfulness and laughter are key ingredients for all successful movements. So please, welcome back Kara. Warm round of applause.
It's funny that this slide is actually the one that's been up this whole time. I'm sure you're all experts at it now. All right, Pete. I have spent much of my career trying to change people's behavior to help nature. Behavior change is hard. Has anyone here ever tried to give up sugar? It's hard, and it's not due to a lack of information that makes it hard. If the goal is to change behavior, to, for example, conserve water or fossil fuels, more information is not necessarily better or realistic. Information alone does not change behavior. Humans behave inconsistently. I have plenty of nutrition information. I know that cookies and cupcakes will make me feel terrible, and yet I still make the wrong choices all the time. So at Portland Trails, we focus on three effective strategies to encourage behavior that will make the local human and natural communities more healthy: relevance, ease, and fun. New research on urban places shows that cities with the happiest residents are designed to encourage interaction between diverse people. And these communities have accessible nature within a 10-minute walk of every home and business. Sound familiar? Being able to get most places by walking or cycling enables residents and visitors to live without a car. In walkable and bikeable cities, person-to-person interactions increase dramatically, and these exchanges build a more resilient and happy community. This year, we are hosting community meetings in East Bayside that enable residents and businesses to determine the neighborhood that they want. And then volunteer workdays turn those ideas into reality. This grassroots approach is not only necessary on a practical level, but core to our philosophy of relevance. People that help build trails and improve ecosystems will ensure their successful future. Not only are we improving infrastructure, a new trail, a pocket park, better stormwater, but also a healthier community of empowered people. Often, human behavior follows the path of least resistance, whatever's easiest. We try to make healthy choices also the easy one. Trails within a half mile of each home, bike racks strategically located. This is not lazy, it's practical. Regardless of walkway design, people take the most direct route, and almost no one walks in right angles. At Portland Trails, we provide the easy route to get to local destinations. People need to get to school, work, and the grocery, and they want to get to breweries, coffee shops, and restaurants. Portland Trails focuses on these important connections in the trail network because we want it to be easy for people to live without a car. Sometimes, though, it's just about fun. If that is also the healthiest choice for people and nature, all the better. When the stairs make music when you walk on them, why would you take the escalator? We can paint crosswalks, like a hopscotch board, music notes, or a giant zipper. We can make them joyful, so that the inner kid in each of us wants to play. And it might just slow drivers down, and then we have a safer intersection. Public, open, and green spaces can be more playful for people of all ages. Play adds joy to life, relieves stress, supercharges learning, and connects people to each other. Want to help us make this place more playful? While all of Portland Trail's efforts help encourage behavior that will make a healthier community through relevance, ease, and fun, we are also making Greater Portland more lovable, because in the end, we care for that which we love most.
Kara was one of my first contacts when I moved to Portland, was Kara. And she was very kind, she was always very gracious. I'm a Maine transplant, so I put my foot in my mouth pretty often when it comes to like pronunciation and Maine conventions and so on. So when she told me that she was doing some work with somebody from LA, and I was like, oh wow, like our Portland trails, it's like telling LA how to get it done. She was very kind when she was like, Lewis and Auburn, we call it, so. So I appreciated that, she did. Next up we have Heather McCargo. Heather McCargo is the founder and director of the Wild Seed Project. She's an educator with 30 years of experience in plant propagation, landscape design, and conservation. Heather loves walking in the woods, hiking up a mountain, and puttering in her garden. Her garden is very different from most. She's a longtime herb and vegetable gardener, but most of her passion for plants is around native species. The flowers, ferns, shrubs, and trees in her yard are the wild type native species, and they're always buzzing with some interesting pollinating insect or fluttering with a bird pecking at caterpillars or seeds. She is a voracious reader of environmental writing, travel stories, and fiction. Heather moved to Portland from Brooksville a year and a half ago. Before Maine, she and her husband, Brian McNiff, lived in Massachusetts and California, moving regularly for their work in horticulture and wind engineering. Heather has a teenage son and daughter and a Lithuanian exchange student in her family for the year. And afterwards, I'm going to have to learn a little bit more about wind engineering. So I'll find you during the intermission.
Portland Trails travel through some amazing patches of mature woodlands at Evergreen Cemetery, Four River, and Pazumskut River, with a diversity of wildflowers, shrubs, and trees. Many of these woodland plants do not exist in young forests and are relics from pre-colonial times. In other Portland locations, there are open grassy areas with meadows of wildflowers. Especially in cemeteries, sites chosen for dry sandy soils, there's hawkweed, violets, bluets, wild strawberry, and pussytoes. Lots of food for pollinators if they're not mown. Many parts of the trail make use of more degraded habitat with a mixture of native and invasive species, such as native oak and red maple, and lots of Asian honeysuckle, knotweed, and Norway maple. These areas could support many more native plants, pollinators, and songbirds with restoration. The trail also passes through areas that are completely devoid of plants. This is the charming historic part of Portland, but before the streets were paved, there were many more trees. Lack of vegetation raises surface temperatures, causes flooding, and supports few creatures. For remnant native habitats to survive into the future, they cannot be isolated. Most pollinators can only travel a few hundred meters. Songbirds need to feed their young the diversity of insects that live on native plants. These isolated patches of native habitat need to be connected. Last winter, Wild Seed Project engaged some graduate students to study Portland for the potential to create pollinator corridors of native plants. This map shows the 1,900 acres of permeable surface in Portland that are potential pollinator habitat. The student's report, called the Portland Pollinator Vision Plan, outlines opportunities Portland has to make a network of corridors of native vegetation in the city to enable bees, butterflies, birds, and plants to live, reproduce, and migrate across the landscape. Anywhere that there is permeable surface, there are native species that can grow, even in tough urban conditions. In the sunny, dry strips along roads and sidewalks, plantings of native drought-tolerant species from sandy or gravelly habitats can thrive. Chokeberry, wild rose, butterfly milkweed, black-eyed Susan, and many other species. These plants would not be mulched, but instead have a sandy ground surface so that the ground nesting pollinators could reproduce. Portland has plenty of opportunities to remove some paving and create bioswale plantings to absorb rainwater, control flooding, and filter pollutants before they wash into our coastal waters. Many wetland plants can be flooded and survive dry spells in the same season. Blue vervain, wild iris, swamp milkweed, pussy willow, and many other native shrubs attract pollinators, are beautiful and resilient to these tough environments that are wet and dry in the same time. An oak tree is a biodiversity magnet supporting up to 500 species of pollinating insects, birds, and animals. Portland needs more street trees. New York City just planted 1 million trees. If they can do it, we can too. It's going to take a lot of support from all of us, but it could happen. No more expansive areas of mulch. There are many woodland plants that thrive in the dense shade of buildings or trees. Purple flowering raspberry, Canada anemone, ferns, wood aster. All these and many other shady sites can be supported with pollinators. Everyone can do something, adding native plantings along the sidewalk or in window boxes or pots. Native plants are very interactive with other life. People quickly notice how dynamic these plantings are compared to common garden plants. Imagine the city of Portland with more of the vegetation that makes Maine beautiful and distinct. These habitat plantings would support the migration of pollinating insects and birds, and these green corridors would also connect Portlanders with nature on a daily basis. Thank you.
Wow. As a civil transportation engineer, I'm very familiar with the median island that's all mulch and a couple of really sad looking shrubs. So if we can get some more native plants in there, that would be certainly great. Next up, we have got Greg Jordan from the Greater Portland Metro. He is the district manager, or just the manager. Greg is a 20-year veteran of the public transit profession. He got into transit by driving campus buses while in college at the University of Connecticut. And from there, he got hired at the city of Tempe, Arizona, as it was beginning to build one of the best multimodal transportation programs in the West. He moved from Arizona to Portland in 2013 with his wife and son. And they look forward to an April move to their new home on Stevens Avenue, which is about 50 feet away from a Route 9 bus stop.
Thank you. Transit. Let's go. Let's go. Put our pistols. Art and transit, we hope to bring more of it to this community pretty soon. This is David Marshall's work, former councilor of the city of Portland. Great work, we want more art and transit, definitely, going forward. National trends in transit. During the last 20 years, there has been a transit renaissance in the US. Beyond the major cities, we are seeing cities across the country invest heavily in bus, rail, and transit, bike, ped infrastructure, complete streets, and as a result, transit use, the top line, is way up across the country. It is going up here in Portland as well. Transit ridership on Metro's bus routes has reached the 30-year high. You can see the 2008 spike, which was brought in by the gas spike in 2008, but we are surging from there. And despite low gas prices, we are still growing, so that's very exciting. Metro's had a long history going back to the streetcar era. Metro was formed actually 50 years ago this year, 1966, but with suburbanization, falling transit investment, and the withdrawal of several communities from Metro, ridership declined in the 80s and 90s. Casco Bay Lines, Downeaster Amtrak, two clear brands, two clear modes of service, everybody gets it. The bus system, four providers, blurred. We don't really know who's doing what. We're trying to fix this by merging, if we can, in the near future, so there's one single transit agency. This map, do you get it? No, I don't get it. I get this map. This is awesome, this is clean, this is simple, this is sort of artistic. This is what we need to be doing with our promotional materials and how people engage with our system. It should be easy, it should be simple. If you take no other word from tonight from my presentation, simplicity is our goal going forward. Expansion to Freeport, Yarmouth. The name is coming out soon. You'll see it in the press here pretty soon, but express bus service connecting all of these communities starting in June. Very excited about that. Last September, we started creating the next generation of transit users. The high school students in Portland have started using Metro to get to school. It's awesome. Our next stop is USM. This is not the greatest or most attractive bus shelter in the world, but it's better than what we have out there today. It's sort of nice, it provides shelter. 30 of these are going in over the next 12 months, thanks to PAX, thanks to GPCOG, and our partners across the region. Also with our partners at PAX and other in South Portland and others, the app is coming in May. Maybe June. I hope May, but maybe June. It's technology. I don't know how it works, but it works. Electronic fare collection. Today it's cash only, exact change only. Tickets and passes are paper. We're moving toward electronic passes, smart cards, and hopefully mobile devices to access buses going forward. Complete streets. I know everybody here gets it, definitely. I have to applaud the city of Portland. Back in 2003, when they approved the Congress Street Bus Priority Corridor, new bus shelters, curb extensions, what we call inline bus stops, so that buses don't have to pull off and get delayed as they travel through a heavily congested corridor. You can see the bus in there. This is not really too much traffic here, but the purpose of the inline stops is, of course, to speed up transit. Everybody accuses transit of being too slow. We got to do things to speed it up. This very crude sort of depiction, if you could hit the button a few more times, our system is pretty radial, focused on Portland. Hit it again. We need to be focusing on the network at a sort of multi-layered way of looking at things. Downtown circulation, neighborhood circulation. Still maintaining those high intense corridors with high frequency service, but also installing and introducing crosstown service so you can go from Westbrook to the main mall without being dragged into Portland. That is it. Thank you very much.
I just got word actually that the app is due in July, they said. Maybe August. Now, isn't it great to have transit officials who you actually are like, I think he really rides the bus, actually. He actually rides the bus. But I don't envy Greg's job because everybody's always got something really bad to say about the bus. Usually people who don't ride it, so don't, you know. But keep it up, we're very lucky to have you, Greg. Next up, we've got the Nason's Corner team. So we have a trio, starting with Lindsay Holt, who is a third and fourth grade teacher at the Breakwater School. She started her career teaching at the Telluride Mountain School, where her love of teaching experiential-based education began. She is excited about sharing her love learning outdoors with her students in Portland and believes that building a natural play space at school is the perfect way to bring nature to the students. Lindsay loves hiking and skiing with her husband and students and looks forward to sharing her love of the natural world with her new baby this summer. And we also have Molly Thompson, who is an artist, educator, designer, wife, mother, marketing director, community builder, and business owner, not necessarily in that order, who loves living in Portland. From 2005 through 2013, Molly was the director of early childhood education at the Breakwater School, where she helped to inspire and lead the effort to redesign and construct the natural playground at Nason's Corner Park, which is really quite something. And we have Laura Newman, who used to teach eighth graders, how to write 5-paragraph essays before discovering her job at Portland Trails and then starting up the School Ground Greening Coalition in 2003. She lives in Portland with her husband, their two boys, and a spotted dog, and has discovered the key to happiness is playing ice hockey. My team has an opening, so we'll also talk in the intermission.
Okay, can you hear me? Yeah. Okay. Yep.
Remember your frustrated parent pointing toward the back door and demanding you go play outside? Remember how excited you were when a teacher granted extra recess or took your science class outside? There's a reason that adults do this. It's because kids move, think, and interact differently outdoors. Whether you are 2 or 72, play is learning. When children muck about outside with stumps and rocks and sand and water, with trees to climb and bushes to hide in, magical creative discoveries occur. This is what inspired me to lead the redesign of the playground at Breakwater School and Nason's Corner Park. So I embarked on a renovation journey, first reviewing the steps that are followed for most of our country's playgrounds. And voila, the result is exactly what it looks like in the catalog. Hard to break, very few movable parts, easy to maintain, lasts around 15 to 20 years. But this is not what we did, and it was not accomplished in three easy steps. Instead, we held a community design charrette, inviting neighbors, parents, city staff, teachers, Little League coaches, parents, grandparents, and children to work with landscape architects to develop a design that supported children's play. Once we had our design, we held community events to raise awareness about children spending more time looking at screens and less time playing outside than ever before. 5 years, many events, several design revisions, and one big drainage project later, approvals were obtained. Ground was broken. Construction began.
Imagine being a kid watching this happen to your playground. Math and physics were all happening right outside our window. My second graders were researching and writing and drawing it all. Children learn best by being involved in authentic experiences. These kids have a sense of ownership having participated in the creation of this place. They will always remember that. As the project was being built, we celebrated, not only to acknowledge what was achieved, but to bring attention to the space and draw in the community. My fellow teachers say that children are playing more imaginatively. Curriculum is coming outdoors. This spring, students will study farming and plant organic produce in pollinator-friendly gardens. They're actively learning to play a role in making the space their own. This is changing our school. The new playground has spaces for gathering together. And spaces for spreading out, for exploring, and for mucking about. 8 years after we began, phase one is completed, and phase two is soon to be underway. And if you stop by and play at the park at the corner of Brighton and Kapizik, magical, creative discoveries are bound to occur.
I actually had a pretty good time playing around in that park once. I was on a through hike of the Forest City Trail. That's right, we had a little stopover. Actually, I remember when I was a kid growing up, the playground around the corner from my house was like this weird wooden structure. I'm pretty sure it was built of like old railroad ties, like creosote and everything. And I got so many splinters and everything. And then they tore it down and they put in one of those ones that they showed on the screen earlier, and I was like, done. Didn't want to go. So hopefully they'll put one back. But next up we have Elise Moody Roberts. One of Elise's earliest childhood memories was in kindergarten being coaxed up Wildcat Mountain by her parents with chocolate. As she herringboned up the alpine ski trails on cross-country skis, she was made fun of by snowboarders and stopped by several concerned older adults, incredulous that anyone, let alone a family as young as theirs, had opted not to take the chairlift. Although they ran out of chocolate, Elise knew it was worth the original humiliation she felt once skiing down the forested backside of the mountain. Elise was often picked up by her father from sporting events with a pair of running shoes in tow, his surprise method of transportation home. Now in her 20s, Elise has left her qualms about standing out as different or even crazy behind and is passionate about educating others to understand that alternative modes of transportation are numerous, beneficial, and absolutely sane and enjoyable. Elise is compelled to change our motorized culture for future generations and inspired by the impact our children and youth make. Elise loves exploring via foot, canoe, bike, or ski. Two of her most enjoyable pastimes are reading and eating cannolis. Mine too. Experiences outside of work that she's found most rewarding have been volunteering at Long Creek Youth Development Center and being a part of the Portland Mentoring Alliance. And her greatest gift in life is her twin brother, Stannis. Shout out to Stannis.
All
I'm disappointed there's no cowbell this year, but this makes more sense with biking. Thank you all for coming. All right. There we go. So I moved to the East End last year, and I joined as a walk leader volunteer. And I'm ecstatic to be working as the walking school bus program coordinator at East End Community School. Our school was chosen as the pilot site for the new Maine Walking School Bus Program, which is a partnership of the Maine CDC, the Bicycle Coalition of Maine, and the Maine DOT, all which we are deeply grateful for. So what is a walking school bus? Logistically, it is like the yellow school bus. Each student is given a bus stop at a precise time, examples being 7:47 and 8:08, where they join their fellow walkers and our adult volunteer walk leaders, arriving at school all together at the end of Nexodus, if you will. Our volunteer walk leaders are the backbone of our program. They each choose one morning to commit to, for example, every Wednesday. We have 5 parent volunteers, then retirees, college students, and young and old professionals. All are vetted and trained and truly are the salt of the earth. Not only do they offer students and their families the opportunity to walk to school, but they teach pedestrian safety. Some walkers begin walking by themselves over time, whereas others stay with the walking school bus as it is a special social time for them and they've fostered relationships with their walk leaders. The kids take great pride as they walk through rain, sleet, and shine, and they are aware of the environmental impact they make. We have frequent walker cards so they can track their distance and we can celebrate their mileage. The walking school bus has a plethora of physical, social, emotional, and cognitive benefits for our walkers. The exercise, positive social interactions, new friends, and becoming part of a group reveals positive changes in school and at home. It also has improved absenteeism. We have 2 routes. We have our Munjoy Hill route, and this is our Kennedy Park route. We have 23 current volunteers and 2 subs. They're all neighbors, so it's a community connector and fosters intercultural exchange, as we have many new Mainers, asylum seekers, refugees. So it's great to be able to bring these people together that are neighbors that may not interact otherwise. We're looking at developing a new route from the Munjoy South development. So we'll be looking for new volunteers. As you can see, we celebrate holidays. This was Read Across America Day. Before we had Crusher join us for Winter Walk to School Day. And this is a national program, so it's nice for everyone to know that we're part of something bigger and this is happening all around the country. Here's us with the Portland Fire Department. It feels great to be supported. We walk right by the fire department, but by the whole community. And finally, a thank you to Coffee by Design and Union Bagel, as well as Hilltop Superette. A complete surprise. Our volunteers expect nothing, but they were given some tokens. I mean, we walk when it is below freezing. So it was nice to offer them a hot coffee as they warm up their hands on their ride back. I have some literature in the back if you're interested in learning more about the school's program or if you'd like to volunteer, perhaps you're a parent, and we can get you registered. So thank you so much.
Do I still have time?
I always see Sarah Cushman or Rob leading the walking school bus on the hill in the mornings. I'm always like, honk my bike horn and like give him a big wave. And you can't embarrass Sarah, so she's always like, hi, Tom. And the kids are just going. So before we get into the next round of presenters, we got a couple announcements to get through. First off, a big thank you to Space Gallery for hosting us this evening. Thank you to, yes, a round of applause. Another thank you to CTN for filming tonight. And the video will be made available on their website and Portland Trail's website soon. So there's a few ways that you can get involved or that you can, you know, watch the video again if you want. And then also I have some announcements here, ways that you can get involved. If you didn't already know, you can check out Portland Trails online at trails.org. I've always marveled at the fact that they got trails.org. Just think about that for a second. Like, before somebody even knew like what the internet was, they had to be like, we're getting trails.org. They got it, so go. And also a new beer has been brewed in support of Portland Trails by, yeah, a collaboration between Rising Tide, Oxbow Brewing, Shipyard, Bunker, Lone Pine, and Gruit. Yeah. All came together for Portland Trails. It's called Portland Trail Mix, and it will release publicly on Thursday, tomorrow, at Oxbow Brewing, 4:30 to 7. Go drink some of that beer. Also, we've got coming up the Gorp Party, which Kara alluded to. I was also, I was at the Gorp Party last year, and I scored big, as she said. I won a boat. Couldn't believe. My girlfriend Lila was on vacation, so I sent her a picture. It was like a boat on her car. She's like, check out what I just got. But that is on April 28th at Arabica on Commercial Street. Right? Okay, thanks. Also coming up is the 10K Trail to Ale, September 18th, and the registration party is on May 19th. At Portland Pie locations, so go register and party and eat pizza. And then finally, my final announcement before we get on to the next round. This is where I'm going to deviate from the script a little bit, if I may. Portland Trails has been really good to me in the 2 years since I moved to Portland. I use their trails all the time. When I moved here and was trying to find a job and orient myself, they didn't give me a job, but they were very nice to me through that whole process, and I really appreciate it. Last year, I was a presenter here, and also, so like I said, at the Gort Party, I won a boat. And when my landlord, Rochelle, who's in the audience tonight, said, you gotta get that boat out of my yard, Portland Trails was nice enough to temporarily store it on their property. So I really appreciated that. So all of which makes it particularly shameful and ridiculous that I admit to you tonight, I let my membership lapse. But I have here a completed application to renew my membership. So I ask that you join me after this, and we form a big line and we sign up Portland Trails. I often think that every city needs, every city deserves a Portland Trails. We're lucky enough to have Portland Trails here. So do your part and become a member and support. And without further ado, we will get on to the next round. Starting with Stephen Wells, who is the senior merchandiser at L.L. Bean and also a Portland Trails board member. He is a Southerner by birth, by way of Richmond, Virginia. Stephen found his way north to Maine some 14 years ago, and he's loved every minute of it. He traded a suit for a paddle, and he tries to get out on the water as much as his family allows. He's also been known to spend time on dry land running 100-mile races. As a registered Maine guide, he loves being outdoors and sharing that passion with everyone. He works at L.L. Bean. He's a member of the Portland Trails Board of Directors, and most importantly, the father of two awesome kids. When he isn't working in Freeport or on a paddle board, presumably not working, or being a dad, what else can he be found doing? Visiting many of Portland's fine breweries, many of which can be found right alongside Portland's trails. That's right. So please welcome Stephen Wells.
All right, going a little micro paddle adventure here. All right, Let's do it. Okay, when most of us look at this map, we see all the great work Portland Trails has done over the last 25 years. Well, I see that and more. And what is highlighted here is a trail around Portland, but on the water. This is a route I followed while circumnavigating Portland in July of 2015. There were six of us that day in varied craft, including one canoe, two kayaks, three paddle boards. We started in the early morning in the Presumpscot River at Walton Park and rode the tide out. Here we have just passed under 295, we're going by the Burley Mile property. This route was 21.5 miles, including one bay, three rivers, 2.5 miles of portaging, and one bazillion strainers, and we tackled all that in under 12 hours. Here we are headed up the Four River with Thompson's Point in the background. All told, in this adventure, we paddled the Presumpscot River, navigated Boat Wake and confused lobstermen in Casco Bay, paddled against the tide up the Four River and rested here on Wingfleet's docks, carried boats and boards through Westbrook, and paddled back down the Presumpscot to home. So the juxtaposition of urban and natural in this adventure was pretty amazing, albeit stark sometimes. Not all of the urban was planned, as pictured here, or even welcome, but it was part of the journey. While the presence of the city was all around us, it also felt distant at the same time. The circumnavigation of Portland presents a view of the city that many have neither seen nor will. This picture and the last were taken at the Stroudwater Dam. This truly is an urban adventure on one of Portland's many great trails. This one just happened to be blue, or some variation of that. Tim Beatley, in his article, The Value of Urban Trails, says many of our best urban trail networks occur along water. He goes on to say, many cities are going even further, now commonly thinking about the potential of blue trails that exist on or in the water. Here's a map of what I think is one of the best developed blue water trails in the country, the Milwaukee Urban Water Trail, which defines a blue water trail as a liquid parkway along a river, lake, or coastline that provides recreational, educational, and or scenic experiences. Those experiences literally surround us in Portland. Many of Portland trails run alongside water trails. Here's a view of the Stroudwater Trail from the river. Back Cove, the Presumpscot, and Four River Trails in Sebago to Sea, which I've also paddled, are other examples. And like a traditional land trail, maintenance is necessary and sometimes much more difficult. Here's my group tackling our first river obstacles of the one bazillion on the Stroudwater. I would argue that navigating these obstacles was the most difficult part of the circumnav and the biggest hazard. The other Portland, Oregon, hosts an annual event called the Big Float. This event highlights the need to care for and provide better access to the Willamette River. That event's founders say the mission of the event is to give our river a big hug. There are parts of our rivers that need some hugs too. This was a gorgeous yet non-navigable part of the upper Stroudwater. When carrying boats over this landscape, it is hard to remember that just around the corner is a major thruway in the city of Westbrook. Nature is a remedy and is right at our back door. So not all of the circumnavigation was floating lazily down a river. Here the group is preparing our boards and boats for the 2.5 mile portage through Westbrook. While the honks and shouts from the cars were less than encouraging, there was pizza and beer in town. Big carrot. There were plenty of opportunities to utilize Portland trails along our paddle. Here we are using the Presumpscot River Trail to portage around the not-to-be-messed-with Presumpscot Falls. You don't have to spend much time on our trails to see how much water is a part of the experience. Blue water trails have the ability to connect people with the water around them and promote stewardship of this resource. Water is medicine. It can heal what hurts us, reduce our daily stress, and just make us smile. I am, for one, looking forward to paddling official blue water Portland trails in the future. That's it. Thank you. You can shut that off now.
Let's just leave that up there for a minute. I don't know if you guys know this, but I have a boat. So I was pretty excited when he was, oh man, it's like, I can, but I don't think my boat's gonna, I don't think my boat's gonna make it. Nobody. We get in fights when we like put it on top of the car, so carrying it like 2 miles is probably not gonna work. Anyway, so next up, I'm really excited about this one. We've got a group from King Middle School. Coming to the stage, we've got Charlie, Taj, Dalia, Siri, and Oliver. With behind-the-scenes help from Jonathan and Josiah. So get another round of applause.
Before I begin my presentation, our presentation, I'd like to give a shout out to Jonathan and Josias, who aren't up here right now. Claps. Hi, I'm Charlie, and my classmates and I are here to talk to you today about our fall expedition, Rethink, Recharge, React. The focus of this expedition was to promote environmental stewardship and knowledge in both our school and our city. We started by hosting energy source themed debates and ended by showing our student-made PSAs at our culminating event.
Our guiding questions are always an important part of our expeditions. They direct our learning. For this expedition, two of our most important questions were what energy source will most reliably take us into the future, and how does engineering affect our energy future?
As part of our expedition, we split up into energy sources such as nuclear, wind, hydro, etc. We then debated against energy sources using the knowledge we gained from our research.
We made PSA videos about actions individuals can take to make the world a greener place. Mine was about upcycling, which is the process of taking post-consumer material, old clothes and such, and turning them into better things. It is a green alternative to throwing clothes away.
Another topic of climate awareness is people power. People power is how people travel while being environmentally conscious, like taking the public bus, biking, or carpooling.
Another great way you can help the environment is through composting. By composting, you can waste less food and save money on trash bags. And since we have Garbage to Garden here in Portland, composting can become even easier. And you should all support Garbage to Garden because it's great.
My PSA was about eating less meat. Did you know annually in the US, 50 billion hamburgers are eaten? If the average American decreased their burger consumption by one a week, we could save 15 million metric tons of carbon dioxide.
Another PSA topic was turn off the lights. The plan was to try and get people to turn off the lights to switch to CFLs. Did you know that if every household in Maine changed to CFLs, there would be a deduction of 235.46 tons of carbon emissions?
In our technology education class, we specifically looked at wind energy, and we even built our own turbines. Wind energy is a clean and renewable alternative to dirty fossil fuels that are leading our world into climate change.
During our expedition, we were contacted by an organization called 350.org. They were organizing climate marches all over the world for the climate summit happening in France. Sadly, terrorist attacks forced them to cancel all of their marches. We then took matters into our own hands and made our own march for both the climate and Paris.
Yeah!
We started marching from King, then proceeded through Deering Oaks, up Mellon, and continued down Congress. We chanted, "What do we want?
Climate action!
When do we want it?
Now!"
We yelled this at the top of our lungs till our throats were sore, but the atmosphere and energy were so great, we couldn't help loving every minute.
Our march ended at City Hall, where a speech was given by the mayor and various other adults. Students recited poetry they had written, and our friend Jonathan wrote and performed a song. We were also given a key to the city.
On December 17th, we culminated our energy expedition. The students in the photo were chosen to speak about our expedition, explaining what we had been working on. We had an exhibition of wind turbines and PSAs.
Climate change is a looming environmental calamity that can be prevented if everyone takes some of the small individual actions we have named tonight. The adults in this world have left us kids to navigate this dilemma, and unless we start taking these steps now, there will be no escape.
Recharge, Rethink, React was an eye-opening experience for me, as I was awakened to the not-so-cold truth that is facing our world. And with this truth, I intend to spread the word across our currently climate-troubled country, in hopes of bringing us to a consensus on the problematic issue. And I believe, as well as hope, that my classmates will do the same.
Thank you for your time.
Wow, man, that is so cool. When I was in middle school, I was like, I want to ride where I'm going, and I want to ride home. It's like, I didn't really see the utility of the bus until I realized that, like, I didn't have to go where I said I was going when I got on the bus. So, this is free marketing material for you, Greg, by the way. Capture that younger generation. Spanning generations here, next up we've got Lori, who is AARP Maine's state director. She leads the state's advocacy and education efforts on health and financial security and livable communities issues statewide. Lori oversees AARP Maine's efforts to engage cities and towns in creating livable communities for people of all ages with a specific focus on economic development and aging in place. Living on Portland's East End, Lori spends a lot of time on the East End Trail and at the East End Beach with her husband Matthew and new rescue puppy Sophie. They are committed to the preservation and accessibility of this beautiful green space and all it offers Portland's residents. Lori's favorite beverage after a hike in the mountains of Mallorca is a Spanish beer, Estrella. In her next life, she wants to be on Broadway. Don't we all?
Okay, whoever put me after that group, you're in trouble. Okay. So why is AARP here? We advocate for people 50 plus and their families. AARP no longer stands for the American Association of Retired Persons. That's because almost a third of our members are still working, and that is growing. In the not-so-distant past, people retired and moved to retirement villages in very non-Maine places such as Florida or Arizona. Today, the vast majority of people 50-plus want to age in place in their current home or community. Such stay-and-put plans have a big impact on Maine, the nation's 23rd state, think 1820, and now the oldest state. According to census estimates from 2014, 8% of Mainers are age 65-plus, and the median age is 44.1, the highest in the nation. Now think about a typical Maine home or town. Most houses are two-story, most areas aren't particularly walkable, and for much of the year, the weather is cold. We are hardy and rugged. The realities of our architecture, terrain, and climate, though, can make it hard to age in place. AARP has established the Network of Age-Friendly Communities as one way to respond to the wants and needs of the aging World War II babies. To join, a municipality's top officials commit to working with local citizens to assess the community's age-related needs, create a plan, and implement it. These are towns that have joined the network. The top ones, the ones on the bottom, are in process. Portland was the first. Go Portland, 66,000 population. Newry near Bethel has 340 residents. Age friendly does not mean old people places. It's not retirement villages or 55 and over developments or adult only buildings or gated communities or assisted living or nursing homes. While AARP Maine focuses on the needs of the 50 plus, to us, age friendly means friendly for people of all ages. After all, a street that's safe for a 70-year-old to cross is also safe for a 7-year-old, a 17-year-old, and perhaps, and we hope, a 12-point moose. Communities in the network are encouraged to work within a framework that's often referred as the eight domains of livability. The theory behind this is that what happens in the eight domains has a direct impact on the quality of life of older adults and people of all ages. Services and features within the domains help make a community a home for a lifetime. Any needed transitions can take place in the home and community you know and trust. So I'm now almost on slide 11 and have been talking for almost three fast minutes. You may be asking, does any of this have to do with green spaces and trails and the mission of Portland Trails? Here's what. Domain one of the livability domains is about outdoor spaces and buildings. In other words, public spaces. People of all ages, especially older people who might otherwise become isolated, need places they can go to socialize, move around, enjoy fresh air, and a change of scenery. Domain two of the eight domains is about transportation, which since the mid-20th century has been dominated by cars, but needs to also include ways to safely walk places, ride a bike, and use public transit. When public spaces are age-friendly and people-powered transportation is a viable option, people of all ages, including our 230,000 members statewide, will spend a day in the park, hit the streets, go for a casual walk or strenuous hike along our state's trails. You can learn more about what we're doing to engage and support local leaders and community residents by subscribing to our newsletter or visiting these sites, or you can just contact me directly. Thank you.
I had a couple AARP jokes, but I'm going to pass. Next up, we have Lori Boxer Makeomer. Lori is a Maine attorney whose legal practice is focused on bicycle and pedestrian law and advocacy, which is like, how many are those, really? She is on the board of directors of the Bicycle Coalition of Maine and is a member of the U.S. Bike Law Network. Lori's first bike was a purple big wheel, which she can still remember riding fearlessly and religiously up and down her childhood street. She now commutes around Portland on her purple big wheel. No, I'm just kidding. On her orange mid-80s Chinelli, which gives her the same sense of freedom as when she was 5. Lori regularly can be found trail running with her dog Lexi. She eats lots of avocados and loves swimming in the ocean. Last summer, she started section hiking the long trail with her daughter Tess and another mother-daughter team. So please welcome Lori.
That's all okay, we'll go with it. So yes, my name's Lori Boxer. Oh, I'm gonna do the clip thing. All right, so we're gonna start you off with this slide from Copenhagen, Denmark, which is designed to get people out of their cars and onto their bicycles and walking. And if you think that this is an idea you might like, you too may want to ask your doctor about giving up your car. Copenhagen's a safe place to ride your bike for many reasons, including infrastructure, lots of bicyclists on the roadway, and driver empathy, and early childhood educations, which have been going on for about 7 decades. The United States is starting to pick up on this idea. In Washington, D.C., we now have mandatory bicycle education for all second graders, which is amazing. And this is about access in so many different ways. In Beijing, we are also working with access. We have 500,000 people that are have access to bicycles and are using Beijing's bike share program, and it's growing. There's another 10,000 bikes being added this year. In Maine, we too have bike share programs. Here's our bike share program in Norway, Maine. Other exciting things going on in Maine include people giving up their minivans for cargo bikes and the increase of sharers on our roadways, telling us that we can take the travel lane when we need to. Another thing that's encouraging that's happening in Maine is that people are starting to understand and enforce our 3-foot law, which requires drivers to give at least 3 feet, sometimes more, to bicyclists when passing them and also to pedestrians. Other laws that everyone should know about is that it's unlawful to take a right turn in front of a bicyclist if it's gonna interfere with their lawful path of travel. Same thing with dooring. And we now need to yield to pedestrians even if they're just showing intent to cross. Bicycle Coalition of Maine is doing amazing things with education, and this is Bicycle Coalition of Maine's Bike for New Mainers program, 12 hours of safety and some time on the road, and these people all get bikes. These are not participants of the Bike for New Mainers program. They're prostitutes in Milan, Italy. And in Milan, Italy, they're required to wear high visibility clothing to perform the tricks of their trade. I also wanted to point out that there are safety issues on multi-use trails. We're seeing more and more cases where, unfortunately, our furry four-legged friends are causing crashes and bicyclists crashing into one another and pedestrians. GP Cog here in Portland is doing amazing work. Check out their website. They are tracking bicycle and ped track crashes all across the city, and these are the high concentration intersections. So we're hoping to use that data to make better intersections like this one in Davis, California. As you can see, there are high visibility cues for everyone, a double crosswalk for bicyclists and for pedestrians, so everyone stays safe. Other data being used, interestingly, is Strava data. Usually athletes use this to brag to their friends and communicate about their achievements and accomplishments, but city planners and nonprofit organizations, state agencies can use this same data to advocate for bicyclists and pedestrians. Oh, this is a bonus slide that shows some of the new infrastructure in Washington, D.C., and this bike path goes right down the middle, but there's some controversy over whether that's actually the safest place for people to be. Finally, I want to make sure everyone leaves here tonight knowing about Vision Zero, which is a safety road safety initiative happening in cities throughout the world, and we're not one of them, and we need to be. Basically, the idea behind Vision Zero is that no loss of life is acceptable, and it's important for us all to think about ways to have zero deaths on our roadways. Thanks.
All right. So if you're going to Milan, leave the high-vis at home if you want to avoid confusion. So I think that's it for our presentations tonight, unless I correct me if I'm wrong. I think that's it. Don't want to leave anybody out. Just a couple quick reminders. Tomorrow, again, there's a beer launch that we'll hope you'll join. The new beer, it's going to be at Oxbow Brewing, 4:30 to 7. The Gort Party will be Thursday, April 28th. Check that out, definitely. Monthly trail volunteer days. Like I said, go to trails.org, and I'm sure you can find information about that. You can volunteer, help build the trails that you use and love. The Trail to Ale 10K is Sunday, September 18th, and you can still register. There's some registration parties coming up. There's a Bayside 5K, 5K9, excuse me. That means so you can bring your dogs, and you can also consult with Lori about whether your dog will cause some legal issues. November, but that is November 6th, that's coming up. And then the Portland Brewers Holiday Dash is in December, so get that on your horizon. Let's get one more round of applause for all of our presenters tonight. They did a fabulous job. What I came away with tonight is we're so lucky to have so many people in our community doing such incredible work. So now we have some time to mingle, have some more drinks, talk to the people who you just saw present. And thanks for coming. And thank you, Portland Trails.